From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
So it gives me enormous pleasure to welcome Ishmael Beah, who introduced himself to the literary world with his searing 2007 memoir about becoming a child soldier in Civil War-torn Sierra Leone. It was an instant bestseller. And as the Washington Post reviewer Carolyn C. wrote, a book that everyone in the world should read. Ishmael says he doesn't remember how many people he killed before he was rescued by UNICEF, but the most remarkable thing he brought was a sense of hope to a story in which horror was the central character. Today, Ishmael is here to talk about another remarkable literary feat, his haunting first novel, Radiance of Tomorrow. Through Beah, we meet Benjamin and Bokari, two friends and teachers who return to their hometown, Imperi, after devastating civil war, to try to rebuild a community on a landscape strewn with femurs and skulls and ribs, to try to live an ordinary life where nothing has been ordinary, to look to the future where the past is still tugging painfully at the present. And one thing I'd recommend when you've heard Ishmael speak and when you look at the book is that you try reading chapters aloud, because it really is imbued with the great grand storytelling tradition of Sierra Leone, where he grew up. Ishmael was born in 1980, came to the US in 1988 to finish high school, and graduated from Oberlin in 2004 with a BA in political science. He's now president of the Ishmael Beah Foundation, which helps children affected by war to reintegrate into society. He lives with his wife in New York City. Please join me in welcoming best-selling author and tireless advocate for the most vulnerable members of society, author now of Radiance of Tomorrow, Ishmael Beah.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm going to get right to it. What I want to discuss this morning, it's this novel, Radiance of Tomorrow. Perhaps it is important for me to explain how the thinking about writing this novel really began. While I was on a very long tour for the first book, which was the memoir, I began, this story took hold of me. For me as a writer, I think usually people try to place you in categories, whether you're a memoirist, you're a novelist, and so on. For me, as a writer, it is the story that wants to come out first, that takes the forefront in you, that gets written. So it could be a fiction, it could be a nonfiction, whatever form it takes, that's secondary to what. So in my case, my introduction to the literary world was through the memoir, which wanted to be told first, and then now this novel. This novel is set in Sierra Leone, but it could be anywhere else in the world. And what I wanted to discuss is the idea of how do people, or why do people return to places that have been devastated by war, natural disasters. Is that even possible to return? And when you return, can you go back to the way your lives have been? If not, what kind of life do you prescribe for yourself? What kind of identities do you choose to embrace? And what does that say about you as a community, as a human being, as a country? And these questions were boiling up in me because in my own country, Sierra Leone, after the Civil War ended in 2002, the media attention immediately, quickly shifted, as it is with most places around the world. If there isn't a crisis, it's not in the news. So I was thinking to myself, well, do people think that as soon as war stopped, people just kind of go back and prancing back in the landscape where they used to live and just start living? So this question was on my mind, and I decided I needed to write about the difficulties, because oftentimes these moments can actually determine whether these countries go back into a civil war or not, the rebuilding period. So I wanted to write a story based on my own observation, based on informal interviews that I had with people in my own country. Now, in my country, Sierra Leone, people are not really privy to interviews any longer, because during and after the war, so many people came and asked questions that actually nobody's interested in answering questions. So when you go and try to interview somebody formally, they would not say anything, or they will only tell you what you want to hear so you can leave them alone. And even when you point a camera at somebody in Sierra Leone, there's an expression that says, snap me, pay me, that if you take a picture of me, you pay me. because the reason is people came and interviewed them and did things and nothing happened. So as a citizen of this country, because it's my home, I speak the languages. I was able to just start conversations about what it meant to return again. And through that, I gathered information informally. So I would lead the conversation in a way that wasn't direct. So this way, people were pretty open with me and told me things. And I also observed. But also, during the writing of this book, I spent a lot of time with my work as a UNICEF ambassador in many other countries around the world. And those places also influenced me. The place that I actually completed the novel was in Central African Republic. So that also had an influence. I was in Congo, I was in Colombia, I was in different parts around the world working. So all of these things came into this narrative. So the narrative starts with an older woman, Mama Kadi, who is walking back into the ruins of her town. And slowly she begins to find strength to return to this place again. She arrives, and two other older people arrived, and slowly people begin to come back into the town. Two friends, Bokere and Benjamin, who later became friends. Children came who had been amputated. Children came who had been former child soldiers. Young women came who had been, as girls, had been raped during the war and now have children that they brought back. So you have people coming who have been on different sides of the war, and how do they learn to live with each other? During the war, one of the things that happened is that the relationship between people changed tremendously. To the point that when people return, you have to reevaluate what your role in community was. How do you become a child again when during the war you've been given a weapon and as you're asked to shoot your grandmother or your grandfather? How do you get accepted? How do people become grandmothers and grandfathers again, parents again? How do all of these people work together? For example, there's a character here, Sila, who returns, he's amputated, and he returns with two children who are amputated, and other children who had been born towards the end of the war, who do not understand what had happened, want explanation why children who look like them do not have arms and limbs. And when they play with them, the hesitation that they have to play with them as they would play. So you see all of these things, how people hesitate in the beginning. For example, before the war, when you encountered a young man walking on a path with a machete in a remote part of the country, you only assumed they were going to the forest to either cut firewood or they were going to the farm to brush a farm or to harvest a crop. But after the war, that same encounter became different, because now when you saw a young man with a machete, you thought also about the war, about how people have been amputated. So how do you learn to pass them on the path without flinching or hesitating? So through this narrative, you begin to see how all these things happen. And of course, how life begins to breed itself through these people again, and what other challenges they face. Now, to write this story required me to do something that was very interesting to me, which meant that I wanted to write it, because it's set in Sierra Leone, I wanted to write it with the echoes of the traditions and the languages in Sierra Leone that are very beautiful. I grew up in a place that was a very strong sense of oral tradition, of storytelling. So even before I ever knew I wanted to be a writer, every evening I would sit around the fire, and my grandmother, any other older person in the community, would tell a story. And this is how we learned about our moral and ethical standards in the community. So even before I thought I could be a writer, I already knew narrative structure through the oral form. And the idea was that when you're telling somebody a story, you have to capture their imagination so that you can bring them to the landscape of the story so that they can live there until you free them. So the storyteller has to have that. And of course, when you're doing it orally, you have to have certain ways of enunciating and say certain things that then bring people into that place, because they're not going to go back and look at the book. So there were certain techniques that were used as a child. For example, when they wanted to tell us a new story, they would retell an older story that we'd heard thousands of times. And through that telling, they would deliberately change certain facts to the story. If no one in the audience protested, they knew nobody was listening. So they wouldn't tell you the new story. So this was how they tried that. So if everybody said, no, that's not the story, then they say, okay, we'll tell you a new story now. And also, after stories were told, young people were randomly called upon from the audience to retell a story they just heard. And if you didn't pay attention, you could not remember the story. And of course, in a small community, you didn't want to be known as the child who doesn't listen. So this would be pretty much, everybody would look at you for the rest of your life. So we paid attention, and we learned and listened to things. And my grandmother was still my moral philosopher, and she would always tell me beautiful things and tell me stories that I didn't really understand. But even before that, when I was a little boy also, my father did something with me that was quite remarkable. In the evening, when he was back from work, we would usually go to the town center where a good number of people would gather. And he would always, I must have been 7, 8 years old, and he would put me on his shoulder, climb on his shoulders, and we would walk. And through that walk, he would tell me to describe what I saw, that we were pretending that he was a blind man, and I, as somebody who can see things, was leading him, and I would describe things to him. So as soon as he was stood up, he would say, so what's going on? And I would say, well, let's go. Let's walk forward. And he would say to me, well, what is forward? I don't know what forward is. And I would say to him, well, you know, everybody knows, well, you walk forward. And I would make the motion. And he said, again, I'm a blind person. So I would say to him, if you want to do anything with any of your feet naturally now, what is the most natural thing that you can do with it? And he would move his foot forward. And I would say, okay, then continue that natural motion. And then we'll continue going. And sometimes he would deliberately walk into a wall or pretend to walk into a fire. And I would say, well, you're going to walk into the fire. And he would say, well, what is fire? And I would say, you know, the thing that burns you. And he said, well, I don't know what this is. But, you know, it's like flames and it's red. And I would try different ways to explain to him so that he can understand. So early on, I believe, as much when I, in retrospect, this was my early training to really explain things to people so that they can understand it, to bring people into a story in a way. So I wanted to give this little context because all of this adds up to the way I wanted to write this novel. I use particularly my mother tongue, Mende, which is a very beautiful poetic and lyrical language. To talk about how when older people speak, they speak in this way. They're not pretending to be flowery. But the way our language is very beautiful and it really takes you to the heart of things, not just Mende, but even other languages in Sierra Leone. For example, in Mende, when you talk about a ball, a soccer ball, if I was to say the children were playing around a football or a soccer ball or any kind of ball, in English, it doesn't do much to your imagination. But in Mende, a ball means a nest of air, a vessel that carries air. So if I were to say to you, the children kicked around a nest of air or vessel that carries air, all of a sudden the reader is going to know immediately that they're somewhere different, first of all, that they're going to come back and look at it again. You know, when I was a boy, you know, Sierra Leone is a former British colony, so we went to school learning the Shakespeare, and we were told the English language is the only medium through which you could express yourself and all of these things and write in it. But when I began to write, I realized as beautiful as the English language is, sometimes it's not sufficient to express certain things from a different culture. So through my writing, I'm always translating. I think about it in various languages, and I try to find the English equivalent of it. And also be careful not to be too flowery so that people can follow the narrative quickly. So that's one example I give you. When you're telling a story in Mende, which some of the things I try to capture in this book, there are also sounds that are not necessarily words that mean multiple things. So if you were to say a character was running, you will say he ran tuk 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 tuk, or she ran kuju 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 kuju. Now people listening know immediately, if you're from the tradition, what those two forms of running means based on the sound. Tuk 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 means the person was running during the daytime. When you're running during the daytime, your footsteps are lighter. So therefore, because other sounds are occurring during the daytime, so they're competing with your footsteps. At night, when you run, because other sounds have quieted, your footsteps are heavier, hence the kuju 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 kuju. So you understand. So for example, if you have a neighbor, the closest thing I can explain to you, if you have a neighbor at night, when they go up and down their apartment to the thin floor, you would hear them more than you do during the day because you're focused on the things of quieter. So when they were telling the story, they won't say the character ran at night or during the daytime. They would just say tuk 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 or kuju kuju kuju, and you knew immediately. So now trying to bring that into the writing form, it's a little bit of work, but I always come out satisfied, and I like that. I'll give a few examples, and then I'll read a little excerpt. When I write also, for me, the characters are not only the human beings. Even nature itself is a character in my work, because I believe that what is unfolding on the landscape nature itself corresponds to that behavior and does certain things. For example, during the war, when there were lots of gunshots, the birds stopped singing. Nature itself was afraid of what was unfolding, that you could not hear the birds any longer. They left, animals departed. You know, even the way the wind moves, you feel like it's going to choke you or something. So there are all of these things. So when in this narrative, you see a lot of these things. I'm going to read some parts that will kind of explain this to you. Perhaps one last example I will give also is that when you say in Mende, for example, that I am angry, the expression of it is saying that my heart is warm or my heart is on fire, pretty much. If you say my heart is cool or is being cooled by water, means that you are not angry anymore. So it literally says the expression, the feeling of it. You know, when you ask somebody in Creole, which is lingua franca, how are you? You say how the body, which means that how is your body? You know, it's not just how it's. So anyway, these things I try to bring into this particular story. But of course, the language also changes. This is not how young people speak in the capital city. So as the novel moves, the language changes as well. Younger people don't speak the way older people speak. So you see that also that also plays a lot in this narrative. Now I'm going to introduce you to just a few excerpts here and there, and then I'm going to take some questions from you. This is the very opening of Radiance of Tomorrow. It is the end, or maybe the beginning of another story. Every story begins and ends with a woman, a mother, a grandmother, a girl, a child. Every story is a birth. She was the first to arrive where it seemed the wind no longer exhaled. Several miles from town, the trees had entangled one another. Their branches grew toward the ground, burying the leaves in the soil to blind their eyes so the sun would not promise them tomorrow with its rays. It was only the path that was reluctant to cloak its surface completely with grasses, as though it anticipated it would soon end its starvation for the warmth of bare feet that gave it life. Now, as this woman is walking, even the path is a character. You know, I'm explaining how the path was waiting for the warmth of bare feet that would give it life. When you walk on a path back and forth, the grass doesn't grow there at all. But as soon as you stop, it waits few months and it starts to grow. It's the same thing when you live in a house. Grass doesn't grow on the rafters of it, but when you stop living there, it's almost nature seizes permission to intrude and comes in. So when I'm writing, I'm this reawakening, this return is happening not only through the human beings, but also through the other elements around as well. And of course, these characters go on to do other things. One last point that I will make, and then I'll open it up, is that I'm not giving away anything, but you know, my walks will never really end with a clean sort of ending, because for me, that's not how life is. Life is always not resolved. There's always something left to discover. So when you read this book and you finish it, you'll realize that it challenges your concept of happiness, which is that happiness is not the absence of challenges in one's life. It is the ability with those challenges to be able to still find joy, meaning, love, and move on. So that's one of the crux here that I'm trying to get across. With that said, we have some minutes left, and I wanted to leave that time for questions. If anybody has any question, you can go to the mics. If you're close enough here, you can ask, and I will just rephrase it. Otherwise, please take the mics. There are two mics in the aisle. And then thank you, Dosfa, for your attention and for coming to hear me this morning. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you so very much. I had the opportunity to speak to a woman who was writing about her experiences during the Iranian Revolution, and she couldn't write in her language that she spoke at home because it was way too personal for her to do it. Mm. I was wondering, when you were first writing, did that ever happen to you, that to be able to tell your own story, you needed to tell it in not the language you spoke as a child, but a language that allowed you the permission to tell the story?
Well, I think for me, the language that allowed me the permission was the language I spoke at home, because everything that I, particularly for the memoir, which I think this person is writing, it was more I could only think in those languages because those were the languages that the things occurred in. So then after that, I would try to translate them into English. But also for me, it is the only way to get at the essence of it, at the feelings of it. You know, when I write, for me, I'm always opening a small window into another culture, into another life. So to bring people, I feel, you, if you avoid that, then, you know, for even the choice of words. For example, I remember when I wrote and I would use the word jubilate. And people would say, well, you can't use that word when we're editing because nobody uses that word. But people use that word where I come from. They will say to you, oh, we're going to jubilate tonight. So for me, the language also fits the landscape. So if you avoid the language fitting the landscape, all of a sudden it sounds strange. For example, older people in Sierra Leone would not say to young people, hey, you guys. It's a very Western usage of the word. They would say, you children, you boys or girls. So you have to make sure the language fits the landscape. Otherwise, the story doesn't quite fit where it's supposed to be. That is my opinion, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
Your story is so remarkable, both your life story and your work. And I think about the children both in this country but in other places around the world who did not have your father, who basically helped you learn how to tell a story and helped you learn how to really look at the world. So how can we reach those children, either through books or in other ways, to help them be resilient when they encounter challenges of all different types, through strife and war and refugees, disasters?
Well, I come from a culture that has a strong sense of community. So my father told me stories, my grandmother, my mother, and other people who were in the community. And so for me, what I could say is that community, a sense of ownership of everybody's life and respecting that is very key to where I come from. But also stories. When I was growing up, we were told that stories, which I believe very strongly, stories are medicine. They are poured into you when you're young so that it can prepare you to face and deal with whatever life would throw at you. So literary stories are supposed to strengthen your backbone. That's what my grandmother would tell me all the time as she would tell me stories. So for me, I think that's what is missing, that connection, that relationship to older people, to people who have lived life so that they can share knowledge about what it meant to live that life. That connection, I think, if you have that, I think you prepare a lot of people to face things. So because that's where I think my resilience comes from, definitely. So.
Thank you.
Yes.
You wrote a lovely and very important book. I have read it, and thank you. My question is about, to some extent, the politics. You talked about, and I see the universality of your characters in the story, mm-hmm. but you are from a particular country in a particular time. And what made me think about the question was I read Achebe talking about Biafra, this book about Biafra. And so I wonder how you think about telling the story of Sierra Leone, or do you think about that in a sort of a broader way?
Well, for me, I always write about families, people. And I would never write straight on about politics. Through my characters, you would know that where they live, things are not going a certain way. Because I think it's, frankly, it's boring to say, well, the political climate in this country is like this. No, you know. Rather, I would have characters, you know, through how they're living for you to experience what is going on in that country. That's all. And perhaps how I write for me is trying to reclaim our voices, for us to tell our own stories, to prescribe our own dreams. And the quote from Albert Camus, who is one of my favorite writers, is really that the role of a writer, it's not to write for those who make history, but rather those who suffer history. So I come from that point of view, really. So when I write, everything that I write, it's political in a way, but it's not overtly in your face, like I'm not dissecting politics, because when politics affect people, that's where the difficulties and the changes and the beauty and the absence of it occurs. So for me, that's where I try to look at people's lives and how they unfold in the landscape in my country and in other places around the world. Yeah. Yes.
Hi, I first read your book in my English class, and I consider myself very, very privileged And I live in the next generation who is in charge of trying to change issues like this, trying to make the world a better place for kids who have it harder than I do. What would you hope we would start to think about issues like this, and what would you hope we would do about it?
Well, as I was mentioning earlier, that for me, when I write, I'm trying to introduce people to places different from their environment. And for young people particularly, my advice to you, being that we are all privileged to be in a place where we can read books, we can go to school, have access to education, is to use those opportunities to expose yourself to the world, to learn about other cultures, to challenge your views about things, not just believe everything you're told. Because it is only through that that you can actually strengthen your own belief system by challenging them, actually. So for young people, is to step out of that, learn about things. You do not need to wait until there's a war somewhere to learn about it. You do not need to wait until there's a crisis somewhere to learn about it. You're on Facebook, social media, befriend somebody in another country, another completely different culture, instead of just people. So that you get to know about people and their lives and their cultures and the beauty of it, and not come with preconceived ideas about who they are, you know? So that's what I would suggest for young people, because this opens you up. And travel. Don't be afraid of the world. Travel to other places. Live in other cultures, not just at the airport or go to the tourist places, but get to know other cultures, you know. Yeah. Yes.
I, too, enjoyed your book very much. I'm wondering about the mining company in yes. Radiance of Tomorrow, and how much some of their cruelty and stuff like that was based on reality.
Well, I think all fiction is based on a little bit of truth, and then you can play around with your imagination and things like that. But of course, the mining is generally based on what happens in many African countries in post-war. In post-war, let's say it's take Sierra Leone, for example, most people don't want to come into certain countries to invest because they're afraid, because the media had painted such a doom and gloom picture of places, right? So what happens, you have a good number of companies with really bad human rights records showing up in these places and asking to get contracts. And then some of them begin to bring about a newer change into these places. They begin to do things that are destroying the people's lives and their land. So that's really what I want to get at this narrative, how that happens and what it does to people. And there's a line in the book that I talk about how what the mining companies were doing was worse than the war, in the sense that during the war, whether people were killed, you were running from your town, you knew you could come back to it at some point. So that nostalgia was there. But what sometimes mining, particularly some of the ways it's done in Sierra Leone, where they would come and they would flood areas, is that they destroy your land so you would never see it again, because they flood it and it becomes a lake, an artificial lake or dam. And for us, African people, our connection to land is different. It's not just a place where we live. It's a place where our ancestors have lived. I think it's the same for everywhere in the world, you know. But in some mining practices, they will literally come and destroy cemeteries if there's a mineral there, and they will dig it. And this is going on around the world, not just in Sierra Leone. So I wanted to show that in the narrative, how that affects people's sense of belonging, of identity, of being rooted to a place, and what that does to the country as well. You know, so. Yeah, so I want to take a question right in front of you. This I met this fellow earlier. Yes?
All right, I just want to say thanks for writing this book. It's incredible. But I just wonder, like, when you write, do you find it to be more painful or joyous? You know, like, I think people write, for some people it's like therapeutic. But I wonder, like, for you, do you find yourself, you know, feeling very anguished at times?
The question, I'll repeat it for the benefit of everybody, is that when I write, is it painful or joyful for me? Well, it's a little bit of both. When I'm writing about things that are painful, of course, I relive them again. So, but when I'm writing about also other things about my people, there's joy and pain. It's mixed. I learned about myself as well as I write. Everything that you write, write you as you write it. That's what J.M. Coetzee said. And so when I'm doing that, I'm discovering about myself. So I have moments of anger. I have moments of joy. I have moments of laughter, just like my characters. In the novel, you get to be all the characters. you know. So there are sometimes I'm a character that's angry, and sometimes a character that's just funny. Sometimes I'm one that doesn't just care about what's going on. So I get to go through all of those experiences, and I insert myself into that world. You know, sometimes I'm even talking to myself. So when, if you ever see a writer walking down the road talking to themselves, they've not lost it completely. They're probably somewhere in their writing, because it happens. You really embody. So it depends on what I'm working on. I could be happy or sad, and I could go through the extremities of every emotion. Writing is a roller coaster. You never know what's going to happen. You're surprised as you write, and you go through various emotions. But at the end of the day, you're left with your own emotions, which is, I'm pretty down-to-earth guy, so, yes.
Slightly similar, referring to your memoir, has writing about your experiences helped you heal at all?
In the beginning, when I started writing my memoir, I didn't think it would help me heal. I just thought it was just torment me, and it did that for a while. But after I was done, I realized that it was the first time that I allowed myself to actually rethink about the experience and actually look at it. From afar, because when it happened and I came out of it, I didn't want to think about it, not because I was afraid, because it's too painful. So through that, I learned things about myself, things that have happened, and I came to terms with something. So yes, in a way, for lack of a better word, it was therapeutic in a way. It allowed me to understand what had occurred to me in my country and to others around me. Yeah. Yes.
I actually kind of have two questions, and neither one's very connected to the other, but my first question would be, you talked about writing in your like native language and how it was more like poetic in a way, and I was just wondering if you thought anything was like lost in the translation from that to English, or like in your mind between that.
Yes, I mean, of course, a lot of things are lost, but I try as hard as I can to get not only the direct translation or the words, word for word, but the feelings more of certain things. You know, I try to get that across as best as I can. But there are certain things that I just can't be translated. It's quite hard to. So what I do, I would describe it in a way so that people can feel it. But it's very difficult. Some things just, there are certain expressions that just would not. But also, I'm writing for people who don't understand the culture, so I'm trying to explain certain things to them so they can understand. And so in a way, you know, for example, the way people shake their hands. And one quick example I'll give you is that in my culture, again, if you grew up in a town, everybody that you grew up with is your brother and your sister, whether they were from the same father or mother, right? So words such as second cousin from my mother's side, it doesn't exist in our language. Because, you know, for us, this means that I won't have to talk to you until Thanksgiving or Christmas. I will never have to call you, you know. So it doesn't exist. So when I go into my village and everybody say, hey, our brother's back. If I'm with friends from the West, they would think, well, we thought you didn't have any brothers, you know. So when I'm writing, I'm very aware of how am I going to give the reader a taste of that community, but also explain to them these nuances so they don't understand that everybody walking around is that brother, you know. So some of these things is hard to translate sometimes, but I work hard at it. Okay. Yes?
You've talked a lot about the impact of oral tradition where you're from on your writing, and also after the Civil War, how people have had to adjust and how their lives have changed. What's been the place of the oral tradition in your country after the Civil War?
That's actually a very interesting question, because after the Civil War, the oral tradition started coming back. But of course, it didn't come back the way it used to be. It hasn't gotten to that point yet, because the population has also changed. Most of the young people are now in the big cities trying to look for opportunities. So when you go to different towns and small villages, you only see a lot of older people and not enough young people for them to transmit that knowledge to. So there's a hunger for the transmission. So for example, when I'm back home and I go down to my village, when older people see you, they sit you down and then they just tell you stories. They think, you know, we got one, let's give him the stories. the stories as much as possible. So for some of us, we're trying to find a way to bring that back, because in the capital city, you don't really have the time for that. People don't have, they're trying to survive in a way. So slowly some of us, but also by writing about it, what I'm doing, it's a way to remind people who may have forgotten that we already have this medicine, this culture, this tradition that is our strength, that no matter what had happened there, when we go back to it and embrace it, is what's going to strengthen us. So for example, I've had Sierra Leoneans who read this book and say, oh, I completely stopped thinking about certain things. I'm gonna, you know, and it would do something to them. So in a way, I write to revive some of it. And some of us are also thinking, some myself and some Sierra Leoneans are thinking of finding ways to preserve that knowledge, that culture, because some of these older people will not be around forever and we don't want that knowledge to disappear with them. So there are moves to do that, but it's slowly coming back. Definitely. Yes.
Yes. Thank you very much for being here. And let me start by saying I have not read your work, but after this, I will. I'll get right at it.
But I did a good job then,
you
yes?
You did good, right. Good job.
Thank you.
But,
all right. Okay.
But I am very curious. You are so eloquent of your love for country and your love for family and your deep roots. I would be interested to know, and I know this is a much longer conversation, but how do you look at the expatriate experience that you're living now? I mean, you've become an American. We are all immigrants of some sort from very few generations ago, and you much perhaps newer than many, but you are an expatriate. And so how are you going to instill those values that you carry so deeply in your children or your wife or because it's very difficult in this country. We are a very transient population. And so, I mean, you are so well-spoken and so thoughtful. I'd be interested in your thoughts on the expat experience.
Well, I don't have to instill it. My wife is from Congo, so she's from similar culture. So we carry those things. And one of the things that I worried about when I started living in the United States, and each culture has their advantages and disadvantages, you know, is that I was very deliberate in my thinking that, you know, one of the ways that one loses your identity or your culture is losing your language. And so when I arrived in the United States, I made it a point to myself that I would make sure that I would not forget my languages in Sierra Leone. So the family that took me in, of course, is American. They didn't speak any of my languages. So what I will do, even when I was in high school, when I started living here, when I'm preparing my homework, I will speak to myself out loud in various languages and always have conversations with myself when I was doing things constantly. And I found communities of people who spoke languages so that I maintained that. Because in my country, for example, and in most African countries, when you go back, which I go quite often, also, I made sure I would go back often enough so that I didn't lose. As soon as you land at the airport, you give your passport, they speak one of the languages to you. If you don't respond, they say you're no longer one of us. It means because when you lose your language, you also lose the mannerisms of that language and the culture. So that's what I made sure. And I love my country deeply that I left, but my heart never left, really. And my spirit never left, really. So I'm here, but kind of there, you know. So I go back, and only when I'm home do I feel completely. It's only the time that my spirit rests when I'm home. So when I'm planning on going back, actually, and I wanted to be back there, a long time ago. So I definitely will go back and start living in my own country again. You know, I couldn't be there during the war for some reasons, and I came and had an education. But I never, and of course, my children, I would definitely make sure that they grow up in my country for them to understand that culture. I think I can do as much as I can if they grew up elsewhere, but there's no way that I can insert that in them. And I think for me, it's only natural that I live in my own country. I don't see any other way around it, you know. Of course, I've lived in this culture. I've taken certain American tendencies. When people ask me sometimes, they tell you, so how can you describe yourself? I always say to them, I am a Sierra Leonean with some American tendencies. And I discover those tendencies sometimes when I go home. And I realize, okay, well, that's not how it's supposed to be, you know, anyway. But that's what I am. I find myself, also, I've been very privileged to be between the two cultures, to experience both. I think it's a very unique opportunity to have. And of course, throughout my writing, as I grow older, I would do things about that, you know, definitely. I'm going to take a fellow Sierra Leonean who's in the audience, who's not to the mic, but I'm going to take a question from them. They're close enough, I can hear them, and I'll repeat the question for everybody. Yes, please, sir, yes.
My name is
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you. So to repeat the question, the gentleman, Mr. Beah from Sierra Leone, again, somebody had asked the question earlier he just touched on, was that, you know, he left and he hadn't been back since the war, but he's saying that based on my work and my writing and things like that, he's read, he's been able to find reconciliation and to think differently about home again. But his question is that if my work is available in Sierra Leone, and he was explaining that by saying that, for example, Heinemann, publishing company, made sure a lot of writers like Achebe, Ngugiwa Thiong'o, and Camus, and all of these people were available in African countries where some of these writers are coming from. It is a very difficult thing because we don't have strong publishing companies in some of these places or necessarily the market for it. So oftentimes publishing houses are reluctant to make it available there. So what I've done in my capacity in Sierra Leone, for my first book particularly, this one came out in January, is that each time I would go home, I would bring a box of books and I would just go and put them in libraries and leave them around, you know? Because for me, I think that, first of all, a young person living in Sierra Leone, I don't want them to pay for my book. If they have that kind of money, I want them to do something different with it. So I can get my publisher to give me as many copies and I can go and just distribute it in a very clandestine way, you know, which I think is great. But there are certain people who are doing things. For example, in Kenya, there are a lot of publishing houses that are trying to change that around, and in South Africa as well. But what you'll be very surprised to learn is this. If you get a book published in the UK, when you sign a contract as a writer, and any British publishing house owns the right to your book, there's a clause to this day in that contract that says that they then own the rights to that book in their former colonies, or the Anglophone former colonies, which means that they would have to publish it there. But when you approach them, they will tell you, well, we have no market. And then I say, well, have you ever tried to create one? They say, well, we're not interested. So either you try to fight back for it to get it, to be able to republish it there, which sometimes if you threaten them that if you don't, I'm going to go public, they usually will give it to you as the author. And so this usually what people try to do, but it becomes quite difficult to get the rights back to do it. But in my way, I've just been taking the books. But as I mentioned earlier, I intend to move back to my country, and one of the things that I want to work on is to change that. I want to make sure there's accessibility to literature, to young people growing up in my culture, to read for fun, not just for school. So I'm going to work on creating that while I'm back home. That's one of the things that I want to do. Okay, one last question and then we're done. I'm sorry we're over time, so please.
I have a very simple question. Yes. I just wanted to know, what are your writing habits? Do you write the same time every day, or do you just write whenever you get the urge, after your breakfast, after coffee, after you say to your family, don't bother me for the next 6 hours? What are your writing habits?
Well, you know, it's interesting because the place that I get inspired the most is my home, but it's the most difficult place to write because the idea that I'm going to lock myself in a room and just sit by myself is very strange to people, right? Just leave me alone. I want to be by myself to write. So, but the way I write, usually I write late at night. If I'm writing, usually when around 1, 2 a.m., that's when I feel like things are quieted and I can think. But I don't have any specific time. It's only when inspiration takes hold of me. The only style that I have is that when I want to write something, I would spend, for example, this book, I would spend months, even a year, just walking around thinking about it, thinking about the names of the characters, where they are, what they look like, everything, and I wouldn't write anything. I would just think. It would incubate in me, and then one day I would just sit down and I would just start, and I wouldn't stop. So that's how I work, usually. So I don't sit and organize, this character goes here and there. It's in my head for a while. I incubate, and then I just sit down, and then it happens. And then, of course, I go and revise. So that's my thing. But I can write pretty much anywhere at any time. When I finished this book, I was in Central African Republic, and it was a great place to write. because there's so much inspiration around, and I can just, I didn't have internet, so nobody could really expect me to respond to their email, so which is also quite good. I had it at a certain given time of the day, so it's only when I would respond to people. And also nobody could call me, because if they wanted to call me, they have to pay for it, because it's expensive. So then everybody left me alone. So you have to find the solitude as a writer to be able to do it, you know. Anyway, thank you, everybody, for coming. And please, I will see you at the signing table. Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.